Thanks a lot. Thanks for having me. You know, people in Sciences Po, they keep asking me whether I am doing economy or political science. But officially, I'm teaching economy. So I'm going to present you today. This talk is about saving the media, capitalism, crowdfunding, and democracy. And in particular, what I am trying to do today, you know, is to discuss this new corporate model for the media I developed in my book. So the Red Book was published in February by La République des Idées, Le Seuil. And it will be published in March by Harvard University Press, which is the other version here of the book, in English. You watch the time for me, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so let me know.
There is the chairperson here.
Who's cheering?
Nobody's cheering. Nobody's cheering. Okay, I chair.
Okay, perfect. So basically, what I'm going to present you by the end of the talk, so before I'm going to raise all the issues linked to the media crisis, is this new corporate model for the media, which is a new type of entity. That I called in the book the non-profit media organization, NMO, which is intermediate in status, as you will see, between a foundation and a corporation. But before turning to the media, to the solution, in fact, I need to highlight what is the problem. And there are a number of different reasons for the media crisis. The first one is the economic crisis, and I'm going to present you a couple of numbers, you know, on the decrease in revenues, not only from sales, but also from advertising. The second crisis the media suffers from is the fact that the trust in the media today is very, very low. I'm not going to spend too much time on this issue, you know, but if you look at any polls, either in the US or in France, you see that less than one third of the people think they could trust the kind of political information that is given to them through the media. And as I am going to highlight, in fact, trust in the internet is even lower than what is trust in radio, TV, or newspapers. So this is not an issue of, you know, not trusting the whole media. In fact, trust in the internet is even worse. So this cannot be like a solution to this crisis. And then we will see what is, for me, one of the fundamental issues we see today is a decrease in the quality of the media. And last week, on Friday, you know, my students in the media class, they had their final exam. And the question I raised in the exam was, are we better informed today than we were in the past? Okay, so these are the kind of questions I try to ask and answer to. So let's begin with this media crisis. And especially, I want to begin with something that, according to me, is key, especially linked to the question of the quality of the media, which is the need for journalists. Okay? It can sound stupid to remind this fact, but to produce information, and in particular what we call hard news, so the kind of news that is useful for democracy, okay? There is this old opposition between hard news and soft news. Soft news would be like entertainment. There is nothing bad about soft news. I spend like a lot of time consuming soft news, but at the end of the day, they are not really useful at the time of election, okay? If you want to have information on elections, on candidates, on corruption, you need hard news. And to produce hard news, you need a newsroom. And there is no information without journalists. And I know that a lot of you, by definition, I guess, you come from abroad. There is this perception, for example, that Le Monde in France is not as good a newspaper as The Guardian or as The New York Times. But if you take the newsroom of The New York Times today, there is more than 1,000 journalists. If you take the newsroom of Le Monde, there is less than 400. So at the end of the day, there is no way Le Monde can be as good a newspaper as the New York Times. Or you will need, then I am back to productivity, you will need Le Monde journalist to be 3 times more productive than the New York Times journalist. So the first question I just tried to answer is very basic. It's about establishing some facts. Is how did the number of journalists evolve over time? So this is the case of France. Here you have the number of journalists between 1880 and 2013. By the way, you can jump in if you have any questions like about like where the data come from or how to interpret this graph. Please ask any question you may have. So this is between 1980 and 2013. You have the blue line is just the number of journalists, and the red line is the number of journalists as a share of the working population. Because obviously, you need to normalize these numbers by something to make the historical comparison to have any sense, and the international comparison also to have sense. So the scale here is from 0 to 4,000. On the other y-axis, from 0 to 0.14% of the working population. So the first thing you see is that if you look at the very long-run trend, you know, back in the 19th century, we have seen an increase in the number of journalists, both if you look at the absolute numbers and the number of journalists as a share of the working population. But what you see is that you have a reversion in the trend beginning in 2010. If you look here, you don't have the impression that this is like a big decrease, especially because the scale is very large, because of the long-run evolution. But in fact, since 2010, the absolute number of journalists decreased from 1 year to the other in France. And more or less, if you look at 2014, we see a decrease in the number of journalists higher than 1,000. Okay? The total number of journalists working in France decreased by 1,000 per year since 2010. So we have a decrease in the number of journalists, and then you can ask whether it will have any impact on the quality of news produced by the media outlets. The other thing you don't really see on this graph is the fact that if you look at the long trend, you know, you can say, okay, you have a little bit of a decrease now. This may be linked to the crisis, so first of all, this may reverse. And second, what we see here is that through time, we have a big increase in the total number of journalists. But then the question is whether the working population is a good way to normalize this question. Especially because if I were to plot the same graph with lawyers, with teachers, with doctors, you know, we see also in France and elsewhere in the world an increase in what we call the knowledge workers. And so perhaps a good way to look at this data is not by normalizing by the working population, but by normalizing the number of journalists by the senior executives and knowledge workers. Okay? And if you do so, in fact, you realize that there is a decrease in France in the total number of journalists back in 1956. So we are in a world in which people are more and more educated. The world is becoming more and more complex. You have more and more scientists producing more and more research. Okay? And the part of the population, the journalists, the ones that are supposed to explain the world to us, in a sense, this as a share of this senior executive and knowledge workers is in fact decreasing. So it's kind of hard to think that over the long run, in fact, we are more informed today than we were in the past. The only reason why it began in 1955, this plot, and not in 1880, is that before 1955, this category, senior executive and knowledge workers, were not even defined in the French census. Okay? So 1954, in fact, is the first year for which we have this kind of data. The fact is that not only we see a decrease in the total number of journalists, okay, so in this plot, when I show you the number of journalists, it's really like all the journalists, okay? The one working for TV, the one working for radio, the one working for newspapers, the one working for the internet. But in the one working for the newspapers, you have the journalists working from Le Monde, but you also have the journalists working for Elle or for Grazia. Okay, you have the journalists working for France Info, but you will also have the journalists working from RTL or Energie. Okay, so this is both journalists producing like hard news and journalists producing soft news in a sense. What we see in the data is that there is also a decrease in the absolute number of journalists working in general information newspapers. And you see that very clearly, for example, if you look at the US. So this is the evolution of the number of daily newspaper journalists, so the one working in the New York Times, the Washington Post, the Chicago Tribune, etc., etc. Between 1978 and 2013, again, in the blue, you have the number of journalists, and in red, you have the same number normalized by the working population. The first things you can see is that the decrease in the absolute number of journalists, it began in the US before it began in France. Okay. In fact, it begins in 2001. In 2001, you had over 55,000 journalists in the US. As of 2014, you have less than 40,000. Okay. So like 15,000 jobs were destroyed within 15 years. So a big drop, you know, in the total number of journalists. This is nearly one-fifth of the profession. And this is despite the fact that we have the creation of a number of new media, okay? You have Vice, you have Vox, you have ProPublica. So you have some new media that appear, that create new journalist jobs, okay? But overall, the number of jobs that disappear is so big that we see more or less a decrease by one-fifth in the total number of journalists working in the US. If you normalize by the working population, in fact, the decrease, it begins in 1986. In a sense, this is a long-term crisis. You see that better when you look at this US data than when you look at the French data. You see that when you look at the French data, when you do the good normalization by the knowledge workers. But in the US, just plotting the absolute workers or normalizing by the working population, you see that the decrease it begins more than two decades ago. Okay. In terms of international comparison, so just looking at 2013, and at the different countries with the number of daily newspaper journalists as a share of the working population, you see that it varies a little bit, but not so much. The country that is doing the best is Japan. Japan is a very interesting case. If you look at the two leading newspapers in Japan, they still have a circulation above 10 million newspapers sold every day, okay? Which is completely crazy, even compared to the number of the New York Times. And especially when you normalize it by the size of the Japanese population. So you still have like a strong newspaper tradition in Japan. The newspapers are like doing better than what they are doing in the US or in France. So you have a bigger newsroom. Then if you look at France, Germany, the US are more or less all having the same number of journalists normalized by the population. Italy is the country with a lower number of journalists. Then the question is, so I just show you some evidence of the fact that we see a decrease in the number of journalists. Then you can wonder whether this decrease is driven by a decrease in the number of media outlets. Okay, just have a number of media outlets that shut down, so the people are laid off, they have without job, and they disappear. Or whether this is due to a decrease in the number of journalists by media outlets. And in fact, we see both things. First of all, we see a number of newspapers that disappear. But the second thing that we see is that we see a big decrease in the size of the newsroom. The average number of journalists by a newspaper in 2001 in the US, it was 39. In 2013, it was 27. So within 10 years, it was divided by one third. Okay? And if you look at all the leading newspapers in Europe, for example, El Mundo, in Spain, you know, you also see this big decrease in the average size of the newsroom. Then you can ask me, why does it matter? Why is it such a big problem? And in a sense, I can come back to this issue of the New York Times versus Le Monde. Okay, the less journalists you have, the lower the quality, or the lower the quantity. In fact, the lower both the quantity and quality of information you will be able to produce. The other point I want to underline is that it's pretty different to have two newspapers with 50 journalists or one newspaper with 100 journalists. Okay. Because they are increasing returns to scale. And especially, let's take just like a newspaper covering a city. There are a number of events that the newspaper will have to cover, even the national newspapers. So for example, if you look at national newspapers today in France, they're all covering the election, plus a little bit of the COP21, okay? Plus perhaps you know what is going to happen tonight for the Champions League and the Paris Saint-Germain. But there are a number of issues, you know, they need to deal with. If you have two newspapers, in fact, you will have a duplication of the effort, in a sense, okay? So you will have... You won't have twice as much information produced by two newspapers with 15 journalists than with one newspaper with 100 journalists. So it matters, in fact, the exact number of journalists working for each newspaper. Okay. The other thing that is kind of important when you look at the size of the newsroom is the fact that, again, the media industry is an industry that is different for any normal industry, for example, the car industry. So let's assume that you have the car industry and that you have a crisis, okay? And then you are selling less cars. You are selling less cars, so you are going to reduce the number of people working for you, okay? Obviously, you have less things to produce, so you will have less employees. At the end of the day, this is not going to impact the quality of the cars, okay? There are less cars to produce, so you have less employees, but the quality of the car will stay the same, okay? In the case of a newspaper, let's assume that you have less readers, so your revenues are decreasing. The thing is, if you reduce the size of the newsroom, you will affect the quality of the newspaper. Because the quality of the newspapers is a function of the number of journalists and is completely independent of the number of readers. At the end of the day, it's not exactly true, but it's more or less the same thing to produce a newspaper for one reader or to produce a newspaper for 1 million readers in terms of how much effort you should put in the newspapers. This is not exactly true because you have some printing costs that are going to increase with the total circulation, and this is not exactly true because you have some distribution costs that are also going to increase with the number of readers. Okay, but if you look at the information production cost, the size of the newsroom, then this is not a function of the number of readers. And by the way, as of today, with the internet, if you look at pure internet players, like Vice or Mediapart in France, for example, or El Español in Spain, then in this case, you know, we don't have this cost that are varying with the number of readers, okay? Like on the internet, you don't have distribution cost, you don't have printing cost. The only cost that is still here is the size of the newsroom cost, okay? And this is completely independent of the number of readers. Okay, so as we will see, one of the big issues with what happened during this media crisis as of today is that the media, they tended to react to the crisis by reducing the size of the newsroom. You have a decrease in revenues. You are going to compensate this decrease in revenues by a decrease in expenditures. To reduce expenditures, the only thing you can do is to fire journalists, what they did. Okay, again, like the average size of the newsroom was reduced by 1/3. But this came at a cost. The cost was a reduction in the number of pages, quantity of articles, perhaps a little bit quality of articles. Okay, and then you have a decrease in the quality of the newspapers. And people are less willing to buy newspaper if the quality of the newspaper decreases. So you have a kind of a vicious circle, you know? Like with a reduction in the revenues, you decrease the expenditures, so you decrease the quality. So then it leads to a decrease again in the circulation because people are no longer willing to buy a lower quality newspaper. So the question is how to explain this crisis and the decrease in the size of the newsroom. And the first thing that I want to underline as an explanation is a long-term decrease in advertising revenues. These are the total advertising spending for Germany, US, and France over all the media, which means advertising spending in newspapers, on TV, radio, in theaters, outside advertisings, okay? All the money spent by companies on doing some advertisings. The US are in green, Germany in red, France in blue. This is as a share of GDP, and it varies from 0.3 to 1.5, okay? 1.5, it means that in the US, for example, 1.5% of GDP was spent to do advertisings, okay? The first thing you see on the graph is that much more money is used to do ads in the US than in other countries in the world, okay, on average. This is still true today. We see like a big drop for the US, but it is still doing better from this point of view than the other countries. Now, the second thing you see here is that there being a big drop, beginning in 2000 in the US, okay, until 2013. So it was 1.4% of GDP in 2000, now it's nearly 0.9% of GDP. So you have a big decline. And this decline, you observe it not only in the US, but also in France, and also in Germany. By the way, these are not advertising revenues of newspapers, okay? We tend to focus to the fact that advertising revenues of newspapers, they decrease. These are all advertising spending, okay? So we, as a society, as an economy, we tend to spend less money on advertising than what we did before. You can think that I am wrong because if you look around you, like we saw advertising everywhere, even more than before, okay? So in terms of quantity, it's not true. But it is true in terms of money because the price of advertising has decreased a lot during the last decade. And the reason is basic microeconomics. You have like supply and you have demand, okay? And when you have a limited demand and an infinite supply, then the price tends to zero. And what has happened with the internet is the fact that the internet is a way to offer an infinite supply of advertisement space, which is not the case with newspaper, radio, and TV. You can have a lot of advertisement on TV, but it cannot be more than 24 hours a day, in a way. Okay? While with the internet, the quantity of advertising had become completely infinite. Okay? So we saw a decrease in the price of advertising. That explains why, despite the fact that we saw more ads today than we tended to saw in the past, we see a decrease in advertising spending as a share of GDP. So first thing you have to remember in terms of advertising, the size of the cake is decreasing. Okay. Then the thing is, newspapers are only one part of the cake. Okay. And here, these are newspapers' advertising revenues in the US, again, as a share of GDP. And you see this big decrease, so it comes from 0 to 0.8% of GDP. It was 0.76 in 1956, at the time it was at its maximum level. Now it's below 0.2. It has been divided by more than 3, okay, within 40 years. Okay. So we see a decrease in the size of the cake, and the thing is, the piece of the cake for newspapers is decreasing even quickly. What is interesting here is that you saw that this decrease is not entirely explained by the internet. In fact, it began in 1956 at the time the media that was competing the more with newspapers was the radio and also a little bit the TV. In fact, advertisement on TV was introduced in the US in 1953. Okay, so in fact, you see that each time you have a new competitor on the advertising market, the newspapers are going to suffer from this increase in competition. So they suffered a lot because of TV, and then you see a big acceleration in the decrease, which is true, due to the internet beginning in 2000. Okay. And one of the things that I'm going to claim is the fact that looking for more advertising, especially native advertising online on the internet, is not going to reverse the trend. Okay? Sometimes you see some fluctuation and you say, okay, you have some fluctuation, but perhaps we'll be able to come back to a better situation in the future. Like if you look at this kind of very long trend that are decreasing trend, I don't see how we would see a reversal in this trend with newspapers being able to win money from advertising in the future. And this is particularly true, for example, if you look at this kind of same plot, but if you divide total advertising revenues for newspapers between print advertising and digital advertising. So this is a reliance on advertising revenue in the US, which means the share of advertising in newspaper total revenues. Okay? This is super high in the US. Here it comes from 50 to 85%. And you see that at some point it was above 80% in the US. You won't see that in European countries. For Italy, for Spain, for France, even for Germany, in general, the reliance on advertising revenues varies historically between 40 and 60%. Okay. Like in the US, it's especially high, with a reliance sometimes above 70, and you see historically above 80%. The reason why I do like this plot is that you saw what happened with the introduction of the internet in 2002. Okay. The decline was beginning here in the reliance, and then there is this apparition of the opportunity to do digital advertising. And it was a way to compensate in the short run the decline in print advertising. And indeed, it worked at the very beginning. And then you see the decrease in both sources of revenue. What happened at the time is that the first newspapers that were able to do some digital advertising, they were offering a new product. And it was a big success. And other advertisers, they were willing to advertise online, okay? But then there were like this issue of like demand and supply, and increase all the newspapers, they began to offer this opportunity to advertise on the internet, so the price decrease. And then we saw this decline in both print and digital advertising revenues. By the way, I am sure that this is exactly the same thing that is going to happen with native advertising. A lot of internet websites, newspapers online, they decided that they are going to do like native advertising, what they call white brand, okay, sponsored content. And they say, this is a new way to advertise, and we are going to do it in a very beautiful way. Like banner ads, they don't work, people, they don't like it, they put ad blockers. So we need to find like a more clever way to do advertising. Let's do native. So people, they think that they are reading something online that is news. But in fact, it's a mix of news and ad. And advertisers, they think that this is an efficient way to advertise. And at the end of the day, it is. Because you think you consume news, but you consume ad, okay? But the only reason it still have some value, okay, and in fact it's an efficient way for some newspapers today to raise money, it's because you only have a limited number of media outlets that are using this way of advertising. And within 6 months or 1 year, you will have all the media outlets doing the same things, and then again the price is going to decrease, and we will see like we will be back to this decline on the of the reliance on advertising revenues. The other thing that is interesting is that the fact that you have this very important decrease for newspapers, despite that we have like a lower decrease in the size, total size of the cake, come from the fact that as of today, with Twitter, Facebook, and Google, you have more or less three actors that are capturing more than 50% of total advertising spending in the world, okay? This is not that the digital advertising market in the US is peanuts. In fact, it's pretty important. This is $43 billion. But all the newspapers together, they are only able to capture 12% of this market, okay? And the big share of this market is just captured by three players, Google, Twitter, and Facebook, which is a big issue. I began my book by highlighting a simple fact, but for me, it's super relevant. If you look at the total revenues of Google, they are twice the total revenues of the entire US newspaper industry. While Google is producing nothing, more or less it's just reproducing content and making advertising revenues out of the contents produced by the American newspapers. And this appears very clearly when you look at this advertising number. We could discuss that later on, but this is one of the reasons why I think that solution like the Google Fund, so the fact that in France, the French government asked Google to give a little bit of money to French newspapers, more or less 60 million euros over 3 years, so 20 million euros per year, it's kind of not a solution because this is nothing compared to all the advertising revenues Google is capturing out the French and international newspapers in general. These are the newspaper total revenues, and obviously you see because of the decrease in advertising revenues, there is a big decline in total revenues, okay? And again, this was divided by 5, from 1% of GDP to 0.2% of GDP between 1960 and 2010, okay? So big decline in the revenues of newspapers. I just want to underline one good news before turning to the solution, which are going to be other good news. But the first one is that media, they can survive without advertising, in a sense, okay? Like the one good example we have in France is Mediapart, which is a pure internet player that decided to have a paywall, okay? This is a strong paywall. If you want to access content, you need to pay for it. You won't be able to consume the content for free, but then you won't see any ad, okay? So the only source of revenues from them is the revenues from sales. A newspaper like the New York Times, since the time it introduced a paywall, okay, it decreased its reliance on advertising revenues. As of today, advertising revenues represent less than half of the total revenues of the New York Times. Okay. And all the growth in the New York Times revenues comes from the increase in circulation and in digital subscriptions. So the reliance on advertising revenues will decrease even more in the future. Okay, so I think the only thing we need to remember, and kind of thanks to the book, I have spent the last years trying to convince newspapers owners about it, Like journalists are very easily convinced. Okay. Owners, it's kind of harder. Because if you tell owners you should rely more on high quality content and less on advertising revenues, they think, but our revenues are going to decrease and our expenditures are going to increase. I'm not so sure that this is a good news. I think in the long term, this will be a good news because no media outlets will be able to compensate such a big decrease in advertising revenues. If you put content online for free in order to maximize advertising revenues, it won't work, okay? You will have more audience, for sure, but you won't be able to monetize this audience, okay? So you'll have more audience, but no money out of this audience, and people, you know, they will lose their use to pay for online content. So it's a much better choice to follow what the New York Times and like more than half of the US newspapers did, or Mediapart did, is to produce content online that is not free, and not to rely on advertising too much. So what could be done? I'm going to begin by presenting you like the bad solution, and then we are going to turn to the good solution. So I don't know whether you know this movie, but this is Citizen Kane. Okay, this was Orwell movie about these big American owners of newspapers. It was inspired by an American that really existed. At the end of the 19th century, beginning of the 20th century, and that owned more than 50 newspapers all over the US. In a sense, I may say that the new Citizen Kane of today is this guy who is
Jeff Bezos,
the founder of Amazon, the owner of Amazon, and the new owner of the Washington Post. The reason why I say this is a good news is that because we listen more and more people telling us, in a sense, the media crisis is over. You have a number of people that are willing to put money back in newspapers. And if you look at the numbers, this is, in a sense, true. You have Jeff Bezos that bought the Washington Post for $250 million. You have Pierre Omidyar that played the same number in First Look Media. You have John Henry that acquired the Boston Globe for $70 million. In France, you have Xavier Niel, multi-billionaire too, in the telecommunication sector that bought Le Monde, Le Nouvel Observateur. You have Patrick Drahi, also multi-billionaire from the telecommunication sector, that bought L'Express, that bought Libération, that bought Next TV Radio, which means BFM TV and RMC. Okay, you have all these new guys that are putting money back into the media industry, which is, in a sense, is something completely new that began, you know, in 2011, 2012. The question is that, is it a good news or a bad news? And there are a number of reasons to believe that this may be a good news. If you talk to a journalist at the Washington Post, you know, he's going to tell you, before Jeff Bezos, and that's true, the size of the Washington Post newsroom was just decreasing, and I was afraid from my job, and I was not able to work in good conditions because, you know, one-fourth of the journalists they were fired during the last decade. With Jeff Bezos, this guy, he hired back a number of journalists. He invested as much money as $250 million on top of the price of the newspapers to build a new newsroom. He built a new website. He's trying a lot of things online. He's also trying a lot of things with local newspapers. So in a sense, you have money back in the media, okay? All these new owners are not like this one. You know, you have all the ones like Patrick Drahi in France, for example. So Patrick Drahi, it cannot be considered as a good news, for sure, because these guys, not only buy the newspapers, but then it tends to fire between one third and one half of the newsroom. So he fired one third for Libération, it was one half for L'Express. So perhaps it will be a little bit more for Next TV Radio, I don't know. He cannot fire 100%, you know, it will be a little bit too much. But in this case, you can say, okay, this is not such a good news because you have people that are outside the media sector that put a lot of money in media outlets, and if off top of that, they reduce the size of the newsroom, this cannot be seen as a solution. But the question is a little bit more complex when you look at Jeff Bezos of Xavier Niel, okay? These two guys, one in the US, the other in France, they invested this money in the media outlets. And they gave journalists, in a sense, money to investigate. They hire more journalists. So they gave like a new life to this newsroom. I want to argue that this may be seen as bad news, and I want to make a parallel with the situation in of money in politics for you to understand why I think it may be bad. If you look at money in politics in a lot of countries, except the US, in fact, that have removed all the legislation during the last decades, but in France, in the UK, even more in Canada, for example, you have a lot of limits on how much people can invest into politics. Okay? So for example, in France, even if you are Liliane Bettencourt, even if you are billionaire, you cannot give 100 million euros to Nicolas Sarkozy for the 2017 presidential campaign. Okay? The more than you can give is 4,500 euros a year to all the candidates and political parties you want to support. So there are very strong limits. Okay? People, they have the money, but they are not allowed to invest this money into politicians or into political parties. There are two reasons why it is the case. The first one is to say money corrupts Congress. Okay? And especially, this is the reason why we are not allowing, except in the US again, firms, companies, to invest into politics. Like a company in France, like Carrefour or Free or whatever company, is not allowed to give money to a political party. Okay? But the second reason why is because we really think that the definition of democracy is one person, one vote, and not $1, one vote. In a sense, to see how money can corrupt Congress, we can look at what happened in the US, given that in the US they removed all the legislation during the last decades. So this is the total outside spendings for election in the US. So here, this is 1990 up to 2014. These are in million dollars. Okay, so here we are up to $1,200,000,000. Okay? Which means that in 2012, for the presidential election, more than $1 billion of outside spending was spent on the election. Okay. By the way, this is not an issue of Democrats or Republicans. The first guys that decided to what we call opt out the public scheme. So, by the way, like you have in a lot of countries public funding of political campaigns. And this public funding, it comes from some limits. And especially if you want public funds, you cannot receive more than certain amount of private money. The main difference today between France and the US is that in France, you cannot say, OK, I don't want your public money. I want to use more private money. You are not allowed to, OK? Because you are not allowed to receive more than a certain amount of private money. Plus, you are not allowed to spend more than a certain amount during your political campaign, OK? There are very strong thresholds. In the US, there is a big difference. In the US, you can say, OK, I'm going to opt out the public scheme, which means, don't worry, don't give me the public money, but I'm going to receive as much private money as I want. And the first candidate that decided to opt out the public scheme in 2008, it was Barack Obama. And in 2012, both of them did it. And in 2016, whoever the candidates, both of them are going to do it too, okay? So we saw a big increase in total outside spending. The reason why it's an issue is that this increase comes from a very small number of people. This is a plot from a paper by Bonica and Howard Rosenthal that is called Why Hasn't Democracy Slowed Rising Inequality? So what they try to understand in this paper is why in the US we see such a big increase in the inequality despite the fact that there is more democracy today than there were in the past. Especially, you know, all the share of the population, the black people that were not allowed to vote until very recently in history. Now everybody is supposed to be able to vote, and despite that, we don't see an increase inequality, and they try to understand this paradox. And one of the explanations is to say this comes from this political, private funding of political campaign. Okay, here you have the share of income that is owned by the top 0.01% of households and voting age population. So you saw that the 0.01% of the voting age population, it has nearly 4% of the total income in the US, which is like yet big numbers in terms of inequality. Okay, So you have 0.01% of the people that have 4% of the total income. Okay, but they contribute for more than 40% in campaign contribution. So more or less, you have 0.01% of the people that contribute more than half of the total campaign contribution, and these guys are at the top of the distribution. So in a sense, they're buying out democracy. Okay, and this raises the number of issues. I can just show you like a graph, one plot, but I could have chosen like 10 others. This one is about the minimum wage in France and in the US. And if you look at this plot, so what you have on the y-axis here in the minimum hourly minimum wage in euros for France, and you have it in dollars for the US on the other y-axis. Okay, this is more or less a parity. You have one euro for $1.2. This is the evolution through time from 1950 to 2013. The black line is the US, the white triangle are for France. What you see, in fact, what you observe is a decrease. This is corrected for inflation, for sure, okay, to have purchasing power parity. What you see is the decrease in the minimum wage in the US since 1980, okay? We can always talk about the optimal level of the minimum wage and whether or not the minimum wage is too high in France today, and this explains a little bit of the unemployment. But the US are basically the only democracy in which the minimum wage is just decreasing during the last 13 years, okay? And this may be understood as the consequences of this kind of things we see here, is that you have only the rich people that are buying out the democracy. So all the decisions that are going to be taken by the political leaders are the ones that are going to satisfy these very rich people, okay? What I want to say, in a sense, is this kind of limits that we imposed in a number of developed countries for money in politics, we could have good reasons to impose the same limits for money in the media. In fact, what I am doing today in terms of research is trying to see to which extent all the regulations that were imposed in a number of developed countries in the 70s, 80s, 90s, 2000s, in order to limit the amount of money you can invest in politics, had consequences on the number of medias powerful people tend to buy. Okay? Cannot spend my 1 million euros every year on politics led by a media outlet, it will work the same way. Okay? And in a sense, what is completely crazy is that if you look at these guys that tend to use the different tools, money in the media, money in politics, they tend to be exactly the same guys. The example being Murdoch in the US, the one with Fox News that spend $1 billion every year on political campaigns, or the Koch brothers. Okay? So in a sense, you know, it's very hard to regulate money in the media, but you can do a number of things. You can do antitrust regulations to avoid, you know, one person to own too many media outlets and to preserve pluralism. The other solution that I'm going to defend today is non-profit media. Okay. Why non-profit is going to work for the media is for the following reason. The fact that information is a public good. Okay. There are a number of papers now that have shown that when people are better informed, they vote more. So first of all, it increased turnout rate, okay? And there are also a number of papers that have shown that when people are better informed, governments have to be more responsive. And especially when you give more information to people, governments, they tend to reduce the amount of corruption, for example, okay? So information from this point of view, it can be considered as a public good. Okay, this is a good that is useful for democracy, the same way than education. This is why I'm going to draw this parallel, you know, between like media outlets and university in a sense. The big issue with information is that this is a public good that cannot be delivered efficiently by the market. From where the need for government intervention? This is not new. You know, government intervention, if you look across the world, you see that governments implement policies and subsidies to support the media in a lot of developed countries. We see a variety of different forms, okay? You have a special tax and legal status for newspapers in France, but in nearly all the European countries, for example, they pay a reduced VAT rate, Okay, this is 2.1% in France. This is 0% in the UK, for example. So this is tax relief for newspapers. You have also different ways to support newspapers. In other countries, the first one to introduce it was the US. You have postal subsidies to newspapers. Okay, they don't pay the postal rate they would pay if they were not supported by the state. You also have direct subsidies to newspapers, for example, in France, where the government gives some money to some newspapers to help them on an annual basis. In terms of financing of the media, in fact, the broadest part of public support is the financing of public broadcasting. You see that here. You know, this is the total public support for the media in 2008. And the unit is euros per capita, which makes cross-country comparison pretty easy. Okay, so for example, here you see that in Finland, per capita, 120 euros are spent per people every year. Okay, this is 71 euros per capita for public broadcasting, and the rest is through indirect press support, especially in Finland, reduced VAT. Okay, you have the same thing in France or in Germany, where the support to public broadcasting in Germany is even higher, as in the UK, with a strong BBC, okay, for which the government is spending a lot of money. The only exception, you know, in terms of strength of the public support, both to the media in general and to public broadcasting in Italy, is Italy. But we all know that Italy is doing super well with its public and private broadcasting. You know, they have Berlusconi, so they don't really need the government. And the other big exception is the US. Okay, in the US, the support to the media in general, and especially to public broadcasting, is super low. Less than 2 euros per capita are spent on an annual basis on NPR, typically in the US, okay, the public radio and the public TV. But this has very important consequences in terms of audience and quality. Okay, and public TV in the US represents less than 5% of the total audience, TV audience. So more or less, there is no public broadcasting in the US. But in the rest of the world, you know, we see a strong public support for the media. The larger part of this support coming from public broadcasting. In terms of news organization and the non-profit form, you know, I'm not the first one to advocate for this foundation model. In fact, we have an increasing number of people that advocate in favor of the development of the non-profit form for the media. One of the main advantages is that, you know, there is always this issue with public support for the media. In fact, okay, I was talking before about the university. If you look at the university, you say that education cannot be delivered efficiently by the market because this is a public good. So in a number of countries, including France, education is going to be delivered in a sense by the government, by public servant. Okay? But this is too complicated to be done for the media, because you don't want a government to deliver information. And this is the reason why, even for public broadcastings, there are very strong tools to preserve the independence of public broadcasters. Okay? Typically, again, except in Italy, when you have a change in the government, you won't have a change in the head of the public broadcasting company. We try to preserve, you know, the independence of public broadcasters from the intervention of the government. Okay, if you look at direct subsidies, people, they may always wonder whether, like, a new government can choose to favor to support one newspaper rather than another newspaper. One of the big advantages of reduced VAT, for example, is that reduced VAT is going to be applied to all newspapers the same way. This is the same kind of advantage with the non-profit form. Okay, with the non-profit form, you don't have a direct subsidy of the government to media outlets. You will have an indirect subsidy through the charitable deduction. So people themselves, they choose whether or not to support a media. The media is a foundation. You give money to a media. And then you will have a tax advantage, tax breaks. Okay. And the government is going to pay for you. So at the end of the day, the government is just going to piggyback on the judgment of private donors about which non-profits to support. The other advantage of non-profit form is that, in a sense, this can be done pretty easily, even if it is not the case. If you look at the law, both in France and the US, if you want to qualify it as non-profit, and this is what is written in the law or in the tax code, you need to satisfy an educational goal of society. As a consequence, in the US, you have more than half of the non-profit media outlets that are owned by a university, because they were not able to satisfy themselves to the non-profit conditions. why the university is able to do it, because the university obviously satisfies an educational goal of the society. So what they do is that they receive the support for their non-profit form through the universities that own them. Okay? In France, basically, we have no non-profit media outlets because they do not satisfy this educational goal of society. But it will be very easy, technically, and I talk about it with lawyers, and this is super clear, to change the tax code and just to change the definition of a foundation and say this satisfies an educational goal of the society of it provides information considered as a public good, something like that. Okay. Plus, in a sense, you have already a number of non-profit media that works well. So either through non-profit public TV stations, for example, or by indirect control by lower levels of government, what I told you before, when you have a university owning a media outlets. In the UK, for example, The Guardian is part of a trust. Okay. So The Guardian, which is one of the main international newspapers, is already a foundation. And it works pretty well, at least in terms of quality. They're losing a lot of money. But at least in terms of quality, they're providing good quality information. The limit of the non-profit model, I want to take another example of a non-profit media company to align them. This is the Bertelsmann Foundation. The Bertelsmann Foundation is not only Germany's largest media firm, but it is also Europe's largest media company. And this is one of the largest media companies in the world, okay? Bertelsmann, this largest Europe media company, is a non-profit entity. By the way, this means that the foundation model, it works for the media, okay? It won't be an issue to be a foundation. The big issue is, in a sense, that there is no voting rights for small donors. You will understand why, like in two slides. But the bigger issue is that you have a concentration of power in a couple of hands. In a sense, let me be back to the example of the Washington Post. What will be the difference between what is happening today, Jeff Bezos investing $250 million to buy out the Washington Post, and Jeff Bezos setting up a foundation, the Jeff Bezos Foundation for the Washington Post, okay, and putting the same amount of money in the newspaper? What we see with this kind of foundation is that Jeff Bezos typically will be at the board of the foundation, will have all the decision power, and if you look at the case of Bertelsmann, if he were to act as the Bertelsmann family, he will be at the head of the board with his wife, his son, his daughters, all his friends. And if you look at the way the bylaws of the board are determined, the board will reproduce itself, you know, through history. So in a sense, having a foundation, this is a good way to reduce your tax. But this may not be a good way to limit the influence on money into the media. Okay? And this is why I propose an alternative solution in the book, which I'll call the non-profit media organization. In French, it's la société de media à but non lucratif. I think it's better in English because you can say NMO, which is like NGO. And this is a little bit shorter than la société de media à but non lucratif. General people, they tend to say, okay, so you propose the creation of la société de media. Yeah, but those don't mean anything. You know, you need non-profit in the title for it to make sense. So the model I proposed in the book is the new model that is intermediate in status between public companies and non-profit foundations. And this is an hybrid model that is inspired in part by the model of the great international universities, which combine both commercials and non-commercial activities. But in a sense, there is more to that. One goal is to secure permanent financing for the media by freezing their capital. Okay? And the second goal is to limit the decision-making power of outside shareholders with constraining bylaws. Freezing the capital is what happened with the foundation, by the way. If you give money to a foundation, you won't be able to have your capital back. Okay? When you invest money in a foundation, this is a gift. Okay? This is not a loan. You won't be able to have your share backs. Okay? Which is really a way to secure the capital of a media outlet, which is also a way to reduce the power, you know, of a main shareholder, because at least they cannot threat the newsroom by telling their journalists, if I am unhappy with your treatment of such or such topic, I'm going to have my money back. Okay? So a good thing of like a foundation is that you freeze the capital. Okay, but the limit is really that you have this couple of people that can have all the power. So what I want to propose in my model is to limit the decision-making power of outside shareholders with these constraining bylaws. This is a non-profit company. So you must invest any surplus revenue back into the organization, which will be a way to avoid, you know, short-term profit maximization strategies. Shareholders are not allowed to withdraw, so you freeze the capital. And you have tax-deductible contributions, okay? But as in a public company, you will have a lot of stockholders, each of them with voting rights. And the important thing is that voting rights do not increase proportionately with the shares in the company. To be more specific, below a certain threshold, let's say 1% of the capital, the stockholders are allowed to gather to form an association. For example, we have editors associations or readers association. The main issue is that if you compare to existing model of crowdfunding, you want them to obtain voting rights, okay? I don't know whether you see all these new crowdfunding campaigns, you know, to help support media outlets. Okay, if you go on a crowdfunding website, for example, Ulule or another one, and you give money to a media outlet, you are simply a donor, which is kind of like funny if you look at the definition of crowdfunding. Crowdfunding is supposed to be like participatory financing, but this is financing, this is not participatory at all, okay? Because you give some money, but you have nothing in exchange. What I want to develop in my model is to have a lot of crowdfunders, small donors. I want you, readers, and I want journalists to be able to invest. They won't be able to invest big amounts, because, you know, we don't have deep pockets. But they can invest small amounts, but in exchange of these small amounts, you know, they need to have some voting rights, okay? The other thing is that above a certain threshold, let's say 10%, the voting rights increase less than proportionately with the capital shares. Okay? So this is really a way to limit the voting rights of the main shareholders. The key thing is that, again, if you create a very small media, you know, you are like a student group, you want to create a small media with two journalists, you don't need 1 million euros of capital. But as long as you want to create like a serious media, like general information media outlets, even with 10 or 15 journalists, you need between 1.5 and 2 million euros of capital. Simple calculations, okay? The thing is that you won't be able to raise this money out of readers or journalists. You need to find some outside shareholders, okay? You don't have to ask, obviously, to Patrick Drahi. You can try to find someone nicer. But you will need to find some money. So the thing is not to say that we don't want these outside shareholders. By the way, Xavier Niel or Jeff Bezos are happy to spend money in the media. Why not? Let's take their capital, but we will have to reduce their voting rights. What we want to do is to limit their power. So in the model I propose is that above 10%, you know, the investments are going to yield only 1/3 of a vote per share. Okay? So you decrease the voting rights of the main shareholders, and the way you compensate these shareholders is through the tax deductions. Okay? And then below these thresholds, for the small stockholders, the investors are going to receive a proportionate boost in their voting rights. So that the total of the voting rights are to sum up to 100%, by the way. Okay? So you have big stockholders, smaller stockholders, you have editors association, you have readers association. Okay? But what we do is that we limit the power of the bigger shareholders and we increase the power of the smaller stockholders. Okay? The advantage of this model is that you have more democratic power sharing, obviously. You have a new place for the societies of readers and employees. And more importantly, you have a democratic reappropriation of the media by those who produce and consume the news, rather than by those who seek to shape public opinion or to use their money to influence our votes and our decisions. Okay, thank you.
Morning, everyone. So first of all, thank you very much for this very detailed presentation. And we're going to start our discussion with the main structure of what we're going to talk about. So we're going to raise some of the issues which you have already listed in your presentation, your new proposal, and then our own contributions, which are basically some questions and concerns, and some other alternative approaches we have found during our research. So The End of Illusion is the title of the second chapter of your book, which I found very nice, because you really tackle some issues you call illusion, I call belief, which actually are very much diffused. And this is the reason why some of the main problems within the media sectors have not been addressed properly. So the the first one, I'm sorry, advertising. There is still not even a great consensus of whether advertising is good or bad for the independence of the media in itself. But the main fact is that this money coming from the revenues from advertising is reducing a lot. So what used to be a great source of independence for the media is not longer sustainable, is not granted for the future. So you have also mentioned the reasons why, so the emergence of direct marketing and the raise in the supply of space for advertising, which is obviously leading to the decrease of the price for it. The second one for me was actually a bit surprising, because we have this idea that competition in the media sector is positive because it brings a plurality of points of view, which should be a good contribution for a democratic discussion. But you show that actually, due to the specific structure of the media market, which is cost very much related on the quality of the news you produce and not on the share of the market you're covering, well, having more actors actually reduces the number of journalists per newspaper, which reduces the quality of the news you produce. So it is a belief that competition is positive, and actually it should be limited in the media sector. Vast internet audience. Yeah, there are so many people who are now reading the news online, and we believe that this is positive, but in fact, they are very superficial readers. They spend much less time compared to newspaper readers on the news. They consume. Actually, the number of unique visitors is lower than the number of people who just go back to the same web page. And most importantly, media companies are not getting much money out of this. So they haven't been able to monetize this increase of readers. And due to the fact that their also revenues from the advertisements are reducing, well, this practice, this providing free news on the internet, is not sustainable anymore. So you should focus more on the quality of the news you produce, and you should have people paying for that. Subsidized media, illusion as well. Yes, you have some sort of tax reduction, tax reliefs, but if you compare the money that the media sector gives back to the state, well, that is actually much higher than the reductions they receive. So it's not subsidized sector. It is just taxed on an overall lower way. And in the book, you argue that since media companies provide a public good, which is information, they should maybe be granted an even more favorable status, and that is if they will be recognized as non-profit organizations. Okay, the illusion of a new golden age. These big, rich guys buy newspapers, whether it is positive or not. I am Italian myself, so I have a very strong opinion about this, and it's not a positive one. And we also have the other issue, this apart from the influence they can exercise, on what is going to happen once their shares will be inherited by the other family members. So having these guys investing a lot of money in this newspaper is not a source of stability in the long run, because everyone else who will inherit these shares can just sell them in case of need, and this is going to affect a lot the environment of the company.
Yeah, and I'm going to present quickly what's your proposal, because you have already done it. So it's characterized by three main points. The first one is that voting rights increase less than proportionally with the capital injected. It's done in order to reduce the power of large investors and increase the power of small investors. There are also some fiscal measures that are implemented to attract these large investors, and investments are irrevocable. It means that investors cannot withdraw their money in order to make these media stronger than before.
we have some questions for you, and what I am going to highlight is mainly the doubts I have from the perspective of a big investor. And my concerns focus mainly on the issue of incentives for them to invest in this new proposal you have, which is the non-profit media organization. So basically, you mention it as well in the book, so why will these people put a lot of money in an organization which will give them comparatively less voting power than their investment? And you mentioned this, the tax alleviation as a main justification. I don't know whether this can be sufficient for these people to decide to commit themselves in such an investment. And that has also to do with the nature of the organization itself, which is a foundation. So in a foundation, you have irrevocable investment, and also you cannot really go public in case of need. So my question is, if I am going to receive even less voting power than my investment, and I cannot even go back, take back my money, are these tax advantages enough to push me to do this this investment? And the third aspect concerning the nature of the foundation is that it can accept unlimited gifts. So I think that, okay, even if you have this very nice and balanced system of adjustments between your shares and the voting powers, I cannot really believe that these big investors will not be able to exercise some leverage regardless beyond their official voting power. So for me, this system of incentives and the effective implementability of this proposal are not too convincing. And the last aspect I'm going to raise is that your system is actually very nice. I mean, it's a very nice way to introduce more democratic participation in the overall management of a media company. But the thing is that if those who invest a lot of money are mainly those people who want to seek control over the media, I cannot see why they will go there if there are other companies we are still working with the old rules. So in order this system to work, every company should adopt these new bylaws, because otherwise, if I'm just working with the general framework of maximizing my own profit and then increase my own influence, I will just not go for that. I will keep on financing those newspapers which are not adopting this new system. So this is from the perspective of the big investors.
I'm going to present two other concerns. The first one concerns the fact that the capital is frozen in your new type of company. And in the case in which this capital is frozen, the medias are in a less precarious situation, and they are strong. They could be stronger, but there is a risk also to freeze medias, because they cannot change their major donor, and so the decision process will be always influenced by the same investors, and it could generate like a lack of dynamism. For example, Jeff Bezos will be the major donor of the Washington Post for an unlimited time, and it could be the same for Xavier Niel at Le Monde. So maybe it's important to keep creative destruction in this sector changing frequently investors. And that's why I would like to ask you if you think that this proposal could freeze the media also. Another concern is about the Olson paradox, which says that If in an organization there are many, a large number of actors who need to cooperate, it will be harder for them to be coordinated and to take efficient decisions than in a smaller group. And it raises a problem for new actors like readers or employees. It will be harder for them to cooperate and take efficient decisions and to have a real counterpower into the organization. And it raises also another issue for the media itself, because if these actors succeed to cooperate, there will be many actors who will influence the decision, and it will be harder for them to take efficient decisions. So now we will present the other ways to respond to this crisis, because we have analyzed two reports which deal with this media's crisis, and both of them are talking about your proposal, not a kind of foundation, but without saying that it's a major reform. Referring this foundation, but not as a major reform. But both of them also acknowledge that there is a crisis in this sector, with a decrease of the number of journalists and the reduction of advertising revenues. The first one has a more neoliberal way, which was written in 2008 to recommend the new politics into this sector. And it's not really optimistic. According to this report, the internet revolution could be dangerous for traditional medias, and especially for these medias which need to reorient their organization. And this report insists on these larger traditional medias, which are the key of this crisis. And according to this report, the government need to help these medias to accompany this transition. And the objective is for them to compete with the large international media companies, and then sweep the other local media companies. And to do so, they recommend to deregulate and to liberalize this sector, cancelling some threshold that limit traditional medias to become bigger and bigger. And they also recommend to invest on these traditional medias in order for them to compete with other international companies and to conquer new foreign markets. So that's another way to respond to this crisis. And the second one is more optimistic about innovation and digital revolution, saying that thanks to the internet, there are many new actors, such as pure players like Slate, Vice, or Mediapart in France, for example, that play an important role, and they are more specifying their demand and more specialized. Digital revolution allows to create new jobs for journalists. They don't have the same job like web journalism. they don't play the same role. Lectors become also active with some comments. They can crowdsourcing, or they can share also content, etc. And there are also new tools for journalists with videos, sound, etc. So and so on. So, but for them, the major problem for these little pure player is that they don't have enough means, and they don't have enough visibility. So they recommend to support these pure players, creating new funds, for example, to encourage investment and innovation, distinguishing some of the new actors with some special awards, encouraging pooling of competencies between these actors, or creating incubators and subsidizing formations for these little actors. So yeah, just want to ask you, where does your proposal is situated into these two other way to respond to this crisis? And that's it.
I can just stay here, no? Okay. Beth, thanks a lot for this very good discussion. I'm going to begin with by answering your very last question, the one about Jean-Marie Charon. I read the report he gave back to the Ministry of Culture and Communication in February or March. There is nothing wrong in this report. Jean-Marie Charon is someone that knows a lot about the media. He works on this issue for years. He met a lot of people to write back the report, especially a lot of people working for pure internet players. So, like, there is nothing wrong, but the proposal he's doing are too far from what need to be done to solve the media crisis. Obviously, if you look at the pure internet players, they need to have some incubators. Each time I tend to meet with them, I see them in different places, and they dream about being in the same place. And you know, when you look at the price of the estate in Paris, it's super hard to find a place where to meet and work. Okay, but they need much more than that. One of the consequences of the report by Jean-Marie Charon was that Fleur Pellerin, the Minister of Culture and Communication, she said that we will have a fund to support the emergence of these pure internet players. Okay. And then no fund was created, and this was transformed, and this was not announced yet, but if you look at the proposals that are on the table, they're just going to fund an incubator. There is nothing wrong about it. Okay, it's nice, and it would be better for these media outlets to have an incubator rather than not to have an incubator. But for working with a lot of them on a regular basis, they need much more than that. And especially, they need to raise money. And they need to raise money by themselves. So they need more support to the support that is offered to them as of today. Compared to what I propose, in a sense, what I propose in the book is a way to take into account the fact that they need money. But they don't need to lose their independence. You have to know about these guys. The guys that are creating pure internet players, as of today, these are guys that decided, or for some of them, they had no choice, to leave their existing media organizations. And they did not choose to create a new one to live back in the exact same environment, especially the one where they could be afraid by the power of their stakeholders. And in a sense, you say that what is in my model is a little bit naive, and it may be true for the existing media outlets, even if, you know, I met after the book, because they asked me, so it was kind of a surprise. I met with Xavier Niel, I met with Mathieu Pigas, I met with Claude Perdriel, I met with all the big stakeholders in France. They wanted to discuss the model. Especially they wanted to discuss the model because I think they have realized that there is a big issue of trust. And the fact that they come from like sectors outside of the media, and that this raised issue of independence, you know, it's not good for trust and the perception of the readers. So they are aware that there is some issue. You know, they don't really agree about my solution because this is very costly for them. But still, they want to discuss it. In a sense, they would like to have it in a softer way. So they are not completely like opposed to it. Okay, but for the new guys, all these new journalists that are creating their new media outlets, they want this kind of models. They are working on writing down their bylaws. And they don't want to write traditional bylaws in which the main stakeholders will have all the power. What they want to write is bylaws in which them as journalists, on top of being like the original small stakeholders, will have some power, plus having some power sharing, decision sharing with the readers. And it's why also they have all this crowdfunding campaign, you know, on a very small scale. So I think there is some hope. There is a lot of hope. In fact, I was like the book, something that really surprised me when it was published, in the number of meetings I had with all these journalists trying to set up new media. They were like, wow, we love the book, we are trying to write down our bylaws, we need some help. So at least perhaps we won't change the big organizations, but we may try to change the new one. And in a sense, this is why I think also there is no way this is going to freeze the media industry as it exists today. First of all, I am not saying at all that the existing media will need to be saved at any price. I really believe into this destructive creation force of Schumpeter. I think it's bad, you know, the day when Libération will disappear from its print version, I will be pretty sad. I was a subscriber to Libération for years. This is my own political taste, and I will be sad, but this is not a big issue. If you have another newspaper, for example, Les Jours, that is a pure internet player that is created as of today by former Libération journalists who was able to develop and to reach equivalent audience. So I think, and for this kind of model, that's true that if Bezos put $250 million in the Washington Post, the money will be there forever, but there is no reason why we could not have other, either big shareholders or enough small stockholders to put money into the Washington Post so that it will change the decision structure. So the idea is, on the contrary, to have a lot of flexibility. My point is to say, if you are Mark Zuckerberg and you create today your own foundation, then there is no flexibility. It's him, his wife, and then the daughter. And it will be like that for like decades or centuries. Where in my model, the idea is to have always like new small stockholders entering into the game and providing new money. And especially given the fact that the smaller one will have voting rights that are going to increase more than proportionally with their capital. In fact, the decision structure will change much more quickly. Because like new small stockholders are going to have a lot of rights despite their small share of the capital. Then concerning the fact that you have a constant flow, do we need a constant flow of gift? I don't agree with that. There are two aspects in the foundation, but it was not clear in the presentation. And in fact, in a sense, this is not clear enough in the book. It appears to me much more clearly, you know, when I put my hand at work and I decided to set up some bylaws with journalists. And then when you need to do it concretely, you realize that there are a number of things you need to add to your original thoughts. The one that is not clear enough in the book is that there will be a mix of commercial activities, commercial revenues, and donations. And why is it a big issue is that if you look at the tax code in the US today, you cannot rely as a foundation too much on commercial activities. So perhaps we will need for the media a little bit of an adjustment in the tax code. Okay? The second thing is that, so first of all, you will have some money for donations, but the main share of your money need to come from commercial activities. Okay. The second thing is that there is no reason why this media has to lose money. They are losing money today. I think one of the big causes of the crisis was the short-term willingness to maximize profit. And this is the reason why the big shareholders, they decided to decrease, a lot of them, the size of the newsroom because of the crisis. They did not have a long-term view. And with the foundation, they will have a long-term view because there is no dividends. So there is no reason, you know, to be willing to maximize profit in the long run. But in the long run, they will have to make money out of their commercial activities, which means out of selling high-quality information to readers, both online and offline. I don't think they should sit and say, okay, now let's wait for more donations. Okay, their aim, long-run aim, should be to be like profitable. Not to have profit margins of 25%, as it was the case in the past, but like 5% is enough to invest in the future. And if you need more money to invest from time to time, then you can have a crowdfunding campaign, like on a given project. I want to do this new website, and then you raise like 500,000 euros through donors. Did I say everything I wanted to do? Yes, two things. I want to underline. Again, back to the model and to which extent owners will have any advantage to choose this model. On top of what I just said, the fact that perhaps it won't work for all media, but it may work for new media. Even if I am thinking about like all media, if I wanted to push my model a little bit further, you can say that they don't really need tax deductions because they're rich. But still, very often, they tend to create foundations. So perhaps it's because they are looking for some tax deductions. But the other thing is that the main goal of my model is that at the end of the day, we can substitute the existing inefficient system of government subsidies to the media by these charitable deductions. And in this case, even if I show in my book that these subsidies are not as big as we thought they are, still they represent a fair amount of total revenues of newspapers. So if the government decided to be like proactive and to tell newspapers, OK, we are a new way to help newspapers, but this will be aimed at NMO, this non-profit media organization, then this will be a big incentive, okay? Because if they choose not to take this new model, they are going to lose all the other subsidies, so this will be a big issue. Last thing, it's like with regards to the Olson paradox. This is why in the first bullet presenting the model, I highlighted the fact that below 1% of the capital, they will have to gather together and to form an association, okay? Because you cannot have an infinite number of shareholders. So I think for very, very small donors, like small donors as of readers or journalists, they will have to form an association, association of readers or association of journalists. And this is this association that will be at the board, the representative of the association that will be at the board of the media outlets. This is something else I realize, and I think it makes the things complicated, but there is always a way to solve this kind of issues, especially with having society of readers of or societies of journalists. When I talked with some media owners, in this case it was La Croix, they were willing to use new like tax opportunities to have new small stockholders that can receive tax deductions. This was a change in the French law in May and June. And then they told me, okay, but this is potentially a good idea, but the thing is that it is too costly for us to have these very small stockholders. Because each time you have a small stockholder, you need to invite him like to a number of meetings, plus to send him documentation, this kind of stuff. So it's true that it's not easy to deal with like 1,000 people having stocks, even if it is what we do when we have a public company. But there are some ways we can try to solve these issues, for example, by having readers or journalist societies.
Okay. Questions?
Hi. Hi, my name is Laura and I have two questions. The first one is, your suggestion was a non-profit media organization, but don't you think it's even the better cooperative model? Nowadays there's some media working as a cooperative and maybe that can solve the problem that that my colleagues raise that the people who want to invest in this kind of society, they want to get some benefit or some the power from it. And my second question is, in Spanish and in Spain, they were analyzing in a documentary why the number of journalists was decreasing over the last 10 years. And one of the factors that they found maybe it's that now there's only a few news companies like Reuters or United Press, International, and so on, providing the most of the news that are published and in the newspaper nowadays. So actually the journalists are not producing news, but buying from these companies. So they say that is one of the factors that can explain this decrease the number of journalists. What do you think about it?
Okay. Take a few questions, maybe, or
I can answer.
Okay. You can answer.
Yeah. Okay. So as to the cooperatives, this is a very good point. This is a point I discuss in the book. In a sense, the model we have today is that if you have all the capital, you have all the voting rights. The cooperative is the extreme opposite. This is one person, one vote, independently of your capital shares, or your investment in the company. In what I propose in the book is kind of in the middle of these two extremes, in a sense, because the more capital you have, the more voting rights you have. This is proportional, but this is not linearly proportional. And you limit the capital, you limit the voting rights of the main shareholders. The reason why I think the cooperatives are not a good solution is because it never worked historically for media outlets. We had a number of media outlets that were cooperative in the past. They all failed. The reason being, we are all humans, especially if you have to decide whether to invest money back in the future or to increase our wage or to have for ourselves like a 13th month and 14th month and 14th month. What we saw is that in the case of these cooperatives, they tended never to like save money to invest it in the future, but to distribute the dividends on a regular basis, which makes sense. These were not people that were like billionaires trying to maximize, you know, the size of their house. They were just people, normal people, blue collar, white collar workers that trying to have their livings out of journalism. And this is something that happened historically. And I think as long as there is not at least a little bit of a correlation about your capital shares and your voting rights, this is a big risk. So I think cooperative is interesting. For me, it raises a lot of questions, and I really do like this model. This is just that it was a failure in the past, to one exception, and it's why I think this is cooperative is not enough, but it can be adapted. Like the only newspaper who works as a cooperative and still, you know, survive as of today in France is Alternative Économique. If you look at the bylaws of Alternative Économique, it's part of their bylaws the fact that they need to reinvest on an annual basis at least 1/3 of their profit. They tied their hands. And I think we could have successful cooperatives for the media in the future as long as they tied a little bit their hands, especially on the share of the dividends they will reinvest for the future. Then your second question, in a sense, is linked to the first one, because if you look at the main wire in the world, Associated Press, it's a cooperative. It's one of the oldest cooperatives in the world. It's a cooperative of newspapers that was created in the middle of the 19th century because newspapers, they were fighting together to be first of the news. This was completely inefficient, especially because at the time, you know, from the US point of view, it was super costly to cover events in Europe, etc. So they decided to create this cooperative to work together to produce information that can be used by all the newspapers that were part of the cooperative. This is how AP was created. Then you have Reuters, and then you have the third largest cooperative in the world, which is a French one, which is Agence France-Presse. I won't blame these wires. On the contrary, I think they are one of the only reasons why that despite the media crisis, we still have like good quality information and especially good coverage of international news. Like they have always been there. The size of their newsroom is kind of stable through time. It increased a little bit. This is not as if we have seen a big increase in the size of the newsroom of AP and Reuters, and then newspapers realizing, wow, they're doing such a good job, we're going no longer to invest in our own news production. This is not what happened. What happened is that newspapers, for example, in Spain, El País, they decided, El País, they more or less reduced the size of the newsroom by 1/3. They decided to shut down a lot of bureaux abroad they had, and then they have to rely more on Reuters. But the fact that Reuters are happy is there, it's a good news. This is not at all a cause of the decrease in the reliance. On the contrary, I think that one of the solutions to the media crisis we see today is to put more money in the production of what we call syndicated news, and the production of news by these wires, and then the media outlets will have this opportunity to bias the news. In a sense, the media outlets will do the pluralism, but at least for the facts, we have these agencies. And we are back to this question of competition. In fact, this was one of the conclusions of the work I did on the whether or not more competition is always good for media, for the media industry. This was my thesis. This big issue, like whether it's better to have more newspapers or not. And one of the conclusions is that it's not always good to have more newspapers, especially because on a given market, you have a limited number of readers. At some point, if you have a new entrant entering the market, you will have a lot of business stealing. It's just going to steal the circulation of the competing newspapers, and both of them are going to have a smaller newsroom. And given the increasing returns to scale I related before, it will have a negative effect on the quality of the news produced by both newspapers. Then one of the solutions, because you still want a lot of newspapers because of pluralism, this is not easy. Like too much competition is bad, but at the same time, we want competition because consolidation and concentration is bad for the newspaper industry. One of the solutions is for the government to fund more, for example, syndicated news production, the wires, so that you will have pluralism at the media outlets level, producing a lot of like news. But at the business B2B level, the one of the wires, then you will have good quality information produced for all these media outlets.
My next question, my name is Katerina. We were talking mostly about the supply side, and my question more for demand side, I think. This is not only my feeling. I was also reading some research, and research saying that today, not only today, but for a long, like for years, decades, the mass people who is demand, so they're not interested in unbiased facts. They're not interested in just information that show you that how it's happened, but they are interested in opinion, in someone's point of view. And that's why more and more people following, I don't know, politicians on their media, social media, because they don't really want to know. Maybe, I mean, they're more interesting in what these people think about it, what the powerful people think about or powerful groups think about it. That's why they're switching to the social media mostly, and they're following like directly from them. So what can you say about it? Thank you.
So this is a very long debate in media studies and in economics, to which extent what we call like media bias is supply or demand driven. Like, are the media like biased because the owner, you know, is from the right or from the left, decided to bias the content of the news, or just because people, they prefer to read biased news? I don't think that having biased news per se is a problem. It's a problem as long as you pretended not to be biased. You know, the kind of motto of Fox News, which was fair and balanced. You know, from the point of view of Fox News, it's a little bit too much. No, but I think, like in France, for example, you know when you read Le Figaro that this is a right-wing newspaper. When you read Libération, you know that this is a left-wing newspaper. And we had all this debate 10 days ago about La Voix du Nord having the front page against Marine Le Pen. I think it was a good choice. Not at all whether they supported or were against Marine Le Pen without doing any politics. At least it was good for a newspaper that had a clear point of view of an issue, not to hide the point of view and not to pretend it to be balanced. They were biased against Marine Le Pen and they made it clear. You know, like for years, you had newspapers endorsing political candidates in the UK, in the US. This is not the case in France, but this is a little bit of a French particularity. This is not an issue to have biased news. Then in terms of social media, this is not exactly right. So you have people that claims that social media, they act exactly as an echo chambers. And when you have your own bias, you prefer to go on social media to find, you know, the little bit of the niche website that is just going to confirm your views of the world. And in fact, people are looking for self-confirmation and are just going to consume very biased news. And given that you have much more supply on the web, then you have more bias because everyone is looking for the niche, and then people are going to be more biased online than they were offline. This was an argument that was made in particular by Case Sustain, that is like a very good lawyer in the US. But some people, they have tried to measure it, whether we are more biased in the way we consume news online or offline. And at the end of the day, they found that it was not the case for a very single reason. Is that people, if you look at the way they consume news, more than half of the people, they consume news, first of all, through Google News and Yahoo News, through aggregators. And then they go directly from the aggregators to the major website. Because the way you know a newspaper is going to appear on an aggregator, the more view it will have, the higher it will be on the aggregator, so the more views it will obtain. And in fact, what we see, and this was a little bit of a surprise to me at the very beginning, is that there is even more concentration in the way we consume news online than in the way we consume news offline. To make it clear, if you look at the first five newspapers in the US in terms of circulation, and you look at their total their share of the total circulation, it's much lower than the share of the total circulation of the first five websites, than the share of the total audience of the first five websites. Okay, in a sense, people, they consume more similar news online than they consume news offline. And that is something you really have to realize, because we have the impression that social media are more biased. We have the impression also that the website, you know, they are much more extreme online. And we have the impression that pluralism is infinite online, because they have an infinite number of players. But these players, they attract such a small share of the total audience that these are not the ones we should focus on. These are the other ones. And the main issue with bias against is, in a sense, that what is happening today It's not so much. You know, if you look at guys like Bezos or Niel, they're not really into politics. Both of them, in a sense, are very similar. They're pretty discreet. You won't find them in magazines. They are never going to show up in political meetings. This may change in the future, but for now, you know, we never saw Bezos either with Bush or Obama or Clinton, neither Niel with Sarkozy or Hollande. So people from the left, they tend to say, ah, he has too many friends on the right, and people from the right, they make the same accusation from the left. But they have their own agenda that may not be a political agenda. What is a big issue is when the journalists from the Washington Post, and this is mainly self-censorship, decided not to deal any longer with Amazon at all, despite the fact that this firm can raise a number of problems in terms of competition, pricing strategies, this kind of stuff. And I think this is more this kind of issue we should be afraid of than the big bias in the media industry, as long as this bias, you know, they are assumed as biased.
Hi, I'm Anna. And as you said, you said that information is a public good. So my question is, don't you do you think that this need to monetize the information end up becoming a source of social inequality in the sense that it restricts the access of high quality information only to the ones who have the money to pay for it? So does this discussion have a relevance today, and what could be possible solutions for that? Thank you.
This is super relevant, and this is something that, you know, I kept thinking about it. The big issue is who pays for the news. You need someone to pay. You have journalists working, they're not going to work for free. The government, per se, is not a very good idea. Or at least, you need then to protect the independence of journalists, which is done through public broadcasting, for example. We have some way to do it. But it's kind of, some people now are arguing that we should also have public newspapers. Perhaps. Why not? But still, this is an open question. Advertisers, I am not very happy when advertisers pay for the news. Because they bias the news, because they try to do whatever they are able to do to mix news with art. Okay? And so then you have the third possibility, which are consumers. Then there is a big question. As of today, I'm working more and more on online news production, and I see that one of the big issues with online news production is that media outlets are stealing their content one from the other. Okay, there is a lot of copy-paste. In fact, if you go on the website of Le Monde, you can find exactly the same content than on the website of Libération, but it can also work the other way around. And then people, newspapers, media outlets have no longer incentive to produce original information. Why are you going to invest so much money to produce original information if you can just steal the content from your competitor website and have exactly the same audience? So then, when I work on these issues, one of my first conclusions is to say, okay, we need to have copyright. There is copyright in the media industry for videos and for image. So for example, if you use a picture taken by a journalist of Le Monde and you are a journalist of Libération, you need to pay for the picture and their official rights, okay? If you use a video done by France 24, and you are France Télévisions, France 2, you need to pay for the video. They are official rights, they are copyright. There is no copyright on the text. And you can say one way to have the incentives back to produce high quality information is to put copyright. But then we face this issue. Then you won't have this public good that is information available for everybody. Okay? And this is a big question. And I think the solution is to have a mix between like newspapers, pure internet players, private ones, producing high quality information, telling it on their print version or beyond the paywall online, and then to have like very good public broadcastings, or why not a public newspapers giving this information for free to people. And perhaps the public broadcaster will have to pay for some information they use from the newspapers through, you know, government subsidies. In a sense, I think we need to find a mix, because we need to fund the production of good quality information, but at the same time, we want this information, at least we want the facts to be available for to everybody. And this is one of the most complicated problems, I think, we are facing as of today. In fact, if you look at the only copyright case there is today between two newspapers, there have been some copyright cases between aggregators and newspapers or news agencies. For example, there have been a case in the US between AP and Google News. Okay. And the newspapers, they are trying to go to court against the aggregators, telling the aggregators, okay, you're making all the money using our own content through advertising revenue. You should pay for the content. Okay. There is nearly no case between like two newspapers because in general, they tend all to do the same thing, you know. So then they don't want to fight into court. In fact, there is one case today in South Africa with one newspaper attacking the other one. The argument of the newspaper that complain is to say, okay, I spend a lot of money to hire this journalist, to build this newsroom, to provide original information. There is a paywall, and the only reason why my readers are going to pay to subscribe, you know, is to get access to this original information. What you are doing, guys, is to copy-paste this information to put it online for free. So then my subscribers are no longer going to subscribe to my website. This is unfair competition. The point made by the other newspapers, at the very beginning, I was sure that they will argue, this was not copy-paste, there is no copyright issue because, you know, we changed this center, we changed this picture, this is all about the fact. They say, okay, yes, we copy-paste, that's true. But information is a public good. This is part of the South African constitution. So we need this public good to be available to everyone. And we are just doing the job, or like, you know, providing access to the public good to the bigger possible number of readers. And we will see, like the case is still in court in South Africa, it will be interesting to see what will be the final judgment. But this is not easy, you know, to choose, say, they're right or they're wrong, because you have the two issues at stake, and I think this is one of the reasons why this media crisis is not an easy crisis to solve, just in terms of like, you know, government interventions, policy implications, these kind of things.
Okay, hello. I wanted to ask two questions. First, is there a possibility that the number of journalists is underestimated because of a change in the status of worker in journalism? I mean, more and more people are working on a part-time basis or in freelance or anything. And second, it's about the concentration on the internet you talk about, who was bigger than with paper. I mean, is there also a possibility that this is not the same concentration as because when you buy a newspaper, you buy only one, you don't buy Le Monde and Libération. But at the same time on the web, I mean, Le Monde is a reference for everyone. Everyone wants to go to Le Monde to see the latest news, and then goes on other websites as a complementary mean. And so, and as a kind of linked question is, how about the place of all those websites who are not really newspaper, but who still draw a large audience? For example, I just looked at Konbini audience on Facebook. It's half the one of the month, which is huge. And Mr. Mondialisation is a really opinion website. It's half a million person in France, and those are not considered a newspaper. I think people working there, I maybe for Konbini, but not for Mr. Mondialisation. People working there are not journalists, but they are a source of information for many people. And Mr. Mondialisation is especially can be considered as hard news in the sense that it's an opinion media.
Let me begin by the second question and the one on concentration. There is a fantastic paper, even if it is too complicated to read, especially in terms of like models, and they are all doing econ, so you can try. That is called Media Power by Andrea Pratt. The goal of this paper that is still unpublished, this is like submitted somewhere, is really to answer your question. That's to say it's kind of different to say, for example, first of all, you say we need to look transmedia and not just newspapers, TV, radio. Okay? We don't need to compute the competition threshold media outlet by media outlet, but what we need to do is to look at the entire media industry. And then we should not look at the total audience, but we should look at what he calls the attention rate. And typically, for example, we should look at the individual level, whether someone that consumes Le Monde, just consumes Le Monde, or consumes Le Monde and watch TF1 and watch France 2, and then Le Monde will just be one third of his attention. and he weighed the importance of the different website, TV, radio this way to compute new measure of concentration. The only reason why he's able to do it, even if he do it with kind of poor quality data, but this is the best that can be done, that he look at individual level survey by the Pew Research Center in the US, where you ask people what kind of news you consume on which kind of channel. TV, radio, Le Monde, newspapers. So then you have at the individual level kind of an estimation of the attention time devoted to each media outlet. This is the best that can be done, but I really do agree with you. We should push forward in this direction, but this supposes that we have individual level consumption matrix that we don't have, for example, for France. I wanted to reproduce the results he has for the US for France, but the data is not even available. But yes. This is the kind of things we should do, and this is the only good way, at the end of the day, to compute the concentration measures. But the Andrea Pratt paper is very good. Even if you don't read it in detail, like the introduction, conclusion, he has the number of plots on the concentration, it's called media power. On the number of journalists, it depends. So the plot I show you for France are from official data, because in France we have kind of a French specificity, which is called the Carte de Presse, a Commission de la Carte de Presse, CCIJP, which was someone that appeared in 1936, but nothing to do with Le Front Populaire. In fact, it was introduced by Lou in 1935, which was a way to define in an official way the status of a journalist with a number of rules. For example, the fact that as of today, if you want to be considered as a journalist, you need to make more than half of your revenues from journalism. The freelancers, for example, or the part-time journalists, they have a card. They have a press card at la Commission de la Carte de Presse. They have a French press card as long as they make more than half of their revenues from journalism. I think this is a good way to protect journalists, because this is the way, you know, for media outlets to have this responsibility towards their journalists, to pay them enough just to have one job and not to have a lot of different jobs at the same time. Even if it is more and more frequent for a journalist to be able to have a fair living, you know, to give some class somewhere or to work as a freelancer for other newspapers, you know, on top of his wage. If for other countries, like the number for the US are from the newspaper Association of American Newspapers, so this is at the newspaper level, and whoever is journalist is the one that is declared by the newspaper, so there is a little bit less control. The only question that is raised, but I know that this is an important one, is the one about like what we call citizen journalism, people that have their own blog, and these guys typically they don't make any money out of their blog, their website, so, and the website itself is not considered as a pure player, like as a media outlet online, so they are not going to be considered as journalists. The kind of question we should raise is to which extent we want to consider them as journalists or not, or as bloggers. Because, you know, the thing is, a lot of people, more and more, they are thinking today, ah, we no longer you need this very old kind of traditional media producing like news with these old journalists that don't even know to use a website, you know. And this is enough with citizen journalism, with having like a lot of people on their own blog producing their own information, we will have much more sources of information. But the fact is, the only media outlets that are able to provide exhaustive, complete general information are this kind of traditional media, either online or offline. And this is not an issue of support, this is an issue of minimal size of the newsroom. And I think we won't be informed enough in the future. Even again, this was my very first example about the New York Times. This is not at all the same thing to have 1,000 bloggers or 1,000 people working in the newsroom of the New York Times. So perhaps we are overestimating a little bit the number of journalists, but conditionally on the fact that we want to consider these bloggers as journalists, and I am not so sure that we want to do so.
You've started your talk with the number of journalists, and you have talked, but maybe less or in a different way, about the independence of the journalist. But I've talked with, for instance, Laurent Mauduit, who is the founder of Mediapart, and I remember there was an audience asking questions: why Mediapart is just issuing so many okay, very important news, very important things. And he says, okay, it's not only because we are investigating more than the others. We all, as journalists, receive many information, and then we have to compute this information and do the investigation. But he says, all the journalists receive information, but then they don't publish this information. So one main difference between Mediapart and the others is that they publish the information they receive. They check, and but then they. So there is more than, maybe I want your opinion about that, but maybe more than the number of journalists, the independence of the journalists is probably the key issue. So this is one of the questions. The other question is related to some of the things that have been said about, okay, if you want to access Mediapart, you need to pay for that. And many people don't have the money for that, don't want to pay, or don't even care about having this type of independent information. So how can we finance this type of information for mass people? And in particular, it's related to your proposal, and I don't know if it's Erika or Basil that asked the question, but in a way, if you want this model to be implemented and to be implemented widely, it means that the business as usual must be stopped, which means a low on concentration of the media and all that stuff. And my fourth question is, did you talk with politicians that really want to go a step forward in this direction or not? And I understand probably it was Erika, because Berlusconi is a very, very good example of problem, very huge problem of the concentration in the media sector. But in France, we know that it's almost the same.
So independence is my next fight. In a sense, I'm doing a report now with in partnership with Reporters Sans Frontières. So Reporters Sans Frontières, Reporters Without Borders, you know, they have this Press Freedom Index on an annual basis. And now they realize the fact that media independence should be part of this Freedom Index. And this should not be only about like people, journalists in jail or journalists killed. Obviously, this matters. But then all the developed countries, it tends to rank super well, and media independence is key. Then the question is, how do we define independence? The way we are doing it in my work with Reporters Sans Frontières will be to define as independent a media outlet that is owned by a company, either an individual or a public company, whose main goal, whose main source of revenues is media. And this is what is going to define Mediapart, and this is one of the only media as of today in France that is still independent, Mediapart. Because if you look at Le Monde, Le Nouvel Observateur today, they are owned by people that are either from the banking sector or from the telecommunication sector. You have the same issue with all the media owned by Drahi, not talking about TF1 and Bouygues, which is from the construction sector, or Dassault and Le Figaro. Okay, and I think this is key to have independence, because the reason why, again, this is not so much about political bias, even if you can have both things at the same time when you have someone like Bolloré, it would be both about like fighting for his own business and fighting for Sarkozy, you know. But independently of the political bias, there is a big issue of independence when your owner has as a main activity something that is not media. Then there is a lot of things you are going to choose not to deal with. And what is even worse is that this creates a lot of self-censorship. This won't be Xavier Niel, he will never show up in the newsroom of Le Monde telling his journalists who should not deal with this issue. But in a sense, the journalists are so afraid that the main shareholder may leave that they are going to choose not to deal with certain issues, you know, not to have any problems. This is a big issue, and I think we really need to create a ranking by country of media independence, and this is what I am working on today. And I have to say that this is not easy. Not only because this is a lot of work, but also because there is a big lack of transparency. And if you take a media like L'Opinion, as of today, they don't want to reveal their shareholders, despite the fact that by law, in fact, they have to do it. But the law, you know, dated back to 1944. So people, they tend to forget this very old law. Talking about capture, so you know, like, this is capture. This issue of like policymakers, concentration, and media. If you look at the program of the Socialist Party in 2011, one of the big issues, like there was a part on the media, I was super happy with it, and it was to introduce more regulation against concentration, because the last time we regulated the media in France was in 1986, related to concentration. It was, in fact, it was not a real law. It was a way for the right that came back in power in 1966 to take the law introduced by the socialists in 1984 and to decrease all the threshold. But to increase all the threshold because they wanted more concentration, you know. So first of all, there is not a lot of concentration regulation. The law is very old. It was pre-internet, and it is not really on top of it respected what exists. So then, yes, I talked to policymakers, and I won't say that the actual government seemed very willing to regulate and to reintroduce concentration. Then you have two ways you can interpret it. Either you can listen to the official argument by the government, that is to say, you know, the media are in crisis, this is not a good time to reintroduce pluralism, we need consolidation, this is the only way we are going to save the media industry. Or you can also think that there is a little bit of capture behind it, and the government need, but this will be the same with the right in this case, the government needs the support from the newspapers, so they don't want to go to war with the owners, so they prefer business as usual. And this is a big issue. But yes, for sure, I think, first of all, we need more transparency. And this, I hope, I will be able to convince some people in the government to do something. Not the government, in fact, but the deputies. To say to the media that you need to respect the law and it should be published, you know, on top of each newspapers, or on the website, or of the TV, or of the pure internet players, who is the owner, what is the capital shares, what is the main source of revenue of this industry. This, let's try. I think we need to protect the independence of the journalist much more than what exists today. I think, for example, with the case of Canal+, we saw that there is no longer protection of journalists against censorship. There were clear censorship in the case of journalists. Nothing was done. I think the government, which is giving money to the media through government subsidies, should regulate these kind of things and protect the independence of journalists much more than what is done. And I think we may aim at doing that under this government. And I think that we need concentration. I think we need law against concentration. I think concentration today is a big issue, but I don't think anything will be done in this direction, unfortunately. So, yeah.
Okay, any additional questions? We're on time. Thank you very much.
Thank you.